old canteens. Roll the blankets, pack the bags with turkey, grits, and beans. Say goodbye to the pellets. Save away my mail. Kiss my darling Susie, I'm bound for a cowboy has to ride the range. And listen to those doggies low and low, low. How along the green campers gleam, and listen to the coyotes wail. I guess I'm just a cowboy, I'm bound. Way out there on the prairie is where I long to be. So give me my rope and my 44 and I'll ride fence free. Just to see that pale moon riding along the rim of the canyons there. I hear that lobo howling and I'm bound in the trail. For a cowboy has to ride the range and he'll listen to the doggies low and low, low. Along the dream near comes the gleam and listen to the coyotes wail. I guess I'm just a cowboy and I'm bound for the trail.
When I was just a little boy, my daddy said, hey son, I'm gonna teach you how to yodel, and boy, you'll have some fun. Well, we live up in the mountains, a lot of echoes live up there, and go out in the open air and sing without a care.
Cody, what do you think of this gathering here?
Here we are at the gathering, everybody's got a rhyme. Since you're all sitting here, I guess I'll tell you mine. Well, I ain't much for poetry, the words just seem to stick. All I really care to do is yodel really quick.
Thank you.
Hey, thank you, folks, very much. Hope you enjoy the rest of the show.
Thank you.
Well, dressing up, certain good folks might mean a suit and a tie, designer socks, a diamond ring, or hair like the 4th of July. But out where we make a living, tennis shoes don't fit the bill. They don't set too well in a stirrup, and I reckon they never will. We're more into jeans, hats, and leggings, 'cause punching cows ain't all romance. But cowboys clean up on occasion, for weddings, funerals, or dance. The dress code for an everyday cowboy ain't changed since Grandpa got wise. Sunday hat, good pair of boots, newest pair of Levi's. Besides, decking a cowboy out in street shoes, a suit and a tie, would be about as good an improvement as croutons on a cow pie. Thank you.
Willie. I'm going to do you one that I wrote. It's a poem that I wrote about my favorite thing to do. Well, anyway, it's right up there with wine, women, and song. And that's working cattle on a good horse. Any cattle. Doesn't matter what you're doing. And it's called a cowboying day. It's just kind of a day in the life. Morning is just a thin line to the east as you steps in the corral and captures a beast. Cold saddle blankets, hey, cock-a-doodle-doo, you buck now, you booger, you break me in two. And your head starts working on the last pass around. Saddle horses are wrangled, draft horses cut out. You shuts the gate and you steps to the ground. It's hot black coffee you're thinking about now, and biscuits and gravy and eggs over light, and the foreman's wife is a beautiful sight. Jokes and jabs and the cow boss's orders, a chew and a toothpick, and you're out the door. And you saddle a horse you'll use for the day, making sure your rigging's got no extra play. He steps aboard light with him all gathered up, because you know firsthand this critter can buck. Ease him out at a walk and head north towards the dump. You'll be asking to trot when he loses his hump. He hits a slow lope on the Badger Highway. It's a cool morning, blue sky, cowboying day. And the brooks are babbling down through the holes, and the meadowlark sings the songs in your soul, and the wildflowers blaze any color you suppose as the smell of the sagebrush and pine fill your nose. Now, the horse that you're on, he's big and he's lean. Quick, tough, smart, and a little bit mean. His saddle's no place for the meek or the green. He's a sure-enough, rip-snorting cowboying machine. And the place that you're headed is pretty intense. Continental Divide is the back fence. There's 10,000 acres of mountain and rock there and 1,200 head to check in the doctor. And to make matters worse, or better, you think, they're all yearling heifers, unpredictable danks. They'll run and they'll hide till hell freezes twice and kick up their heels as you skate on the ice. But this ain't no colt, and you ain't no kid. So you jerks out your rope and you pulls down your lid and you climbs and you cruises the sagebrush and aspen till you finds your cow brute what's droopy and rasping. And you tags her just before she gets to the brush and trips her and ties her in a big rush and packs her with sulfa and penicillin, she'll turn for the better, the good Lord willing. Lots of foot rot and pink eye today. But that don't mean the boogers can't play. They've ducked and they've dodged till who laid a chunk. But you managed to capture a pretty good hunk. Line-backed old heifer with a sly side dart. Almost upset the whole apple cart. And a bald-faced old bag sure slammed on her brakes when we dived off a ledge and got in her way. It's the heat of the day now. Sun straight overhead, and you and your hoss is packing some lead. You hanker for rest and a biscuit or two, and you figures you got that much coming to you. Now your horse likes the grass that grows beneath the aspen, and the shade there is welcome as peace everlasting. So you find such a place with a creek close by to soothe the bruises of a hard ride. Hobbles him, unbridles him, loosens his girth, and set yourself down in the cool green earth, surrounds your grub and drinks your fill, and takes a siesta way back in the hill. A catnap is all you require. Still you lay there and ponder a thought. The world sure has its briars. Take, for instance, this good old cow hoss. He was a wild-eyed ring-tailed dandy. They give up on him before they give him to me, but it's the same for horses as it is for men. He just needed a job and a kick in his shin. Well, the afternoon spent with the usual flair, a close call here, a catastrophe there, but still you save more than a couple of hides. That's why you get paid for making these rides. The storm blew through for about 30 minutes, and you'd swear that Satan himself was in it. You're sure glad your pony is seasoned plumb through. Close lightning's unloaded a few buckaroos. You're wet as a fish, but you ain't gonna melt. And the sun feels the best it ever has felt. You're all steamed up like an overdue freight, but you're dry as a duck time you go through the gate. Now, there's those thinks that cowboys are a crude, ignorant cuss. Truth is, we no savvy them. They no savvy us. But there's one chore that sticks in my mind when a cowboy's job cuts into sublime. It's when you and your horse form a leathery feather and drift 2-3 yearlings out of a gather and trail them up someplace they don't want to go when they're needing a vet or whatever, you know. You sit them just so when you go through a gate. And don't rile them up, for heaven's sake. Those that have tried it say it's kind of an art to set them in the home corral before dark. And we're trailing two of them home this night. We'll probably ship one, the other be all right. But one wrong move, now the air's turning cool, and these two yearling heifers make you look like a fool. Punch him into the catch with a whoop and a smile. You've been walking on eggs for the last 2 miles. And if one would have broke, the fur would have flew. No telling when you'd got another crack at them, too. Your horse rolls in the dirt while you put up your tack. Then savors his grain while you scratch his back. It's an evening ritual you both enjoy. You don't covet nothing when you ride this old boy. And he heads for the Timothy down by the lake, and you saunters towards the house for soup and steak to mix it up with compadres and finish your pie like folks do when they're satisfied. When supper's done, there's little time for play. You sleep hard all night if you work hard all day, and before you fall off your log to float in the air, you may have time for a little prayer. Lord, I thank you for this cowboying day. I had me some fun earning my pay, and I like to think I keep meat on the table for a country that needs to keep fit and able. But a cow with no horse, Lord, is boring as hell. And a horse with no cows don't ring my bells. It's a good life, this game of horses and cattle. And thanks again, Lord, for my day in the saddle. Amen.
You know, I remember making hay with my dad. We put it up in stacks. Dad had one of those stack frames, and he'd fill her to the max. Then sometimes, but not often, he'd say, "Rodney, you've the knack. Grab a fork, I'll lift you up, and you top off the stack." 'Twas reluctantly I'd take that fork. He'd set me up on top. Seemed like I'd stack that hay to 30 feet before he'd finally stop. Then he'd drive up really close. I could see him down beneath as I stepped out on the push-off on the end of the stacker teeth. He'd back up for a little ways. I hoped he'd try no tricks. But giving me rides in that farmhand was how he got his kicks. Wasn't long till I'd get mad. I'd had these rides before. He'd slide that push off almost in, and he'd run her out once more. "Come on, Dad, let me down. This really isn't fair." Then he'd point the teeth towards the ground, leave me dangling in the air. I could hear him laughing down below in hopeless choking mirth, and I'd wonder if I'd ever again set my feet upon the earth. Well, it was no use to argue. He wouldn't quit till he was done. But I always, always wondered, how could this be so fun? Well, our yard light burned out last year. Since I'd run that farmhand all my life, I knew we could fix it in a minute if I could convince my wife. Wasn't easy to convince her. She claimed a housewife was her role. Though mad she was, she climbed aboard, took a ride to the top of the pole. I said, "Sweetheart, I'm so proud of you," when she fixed that light. "And you're especially lovely when you're angry. You really are a sight." "Let me down, you worthless cur." She was having a full-fledged fit. Well, I couldn't pass up a chance like this, so I drove around a bit. Good, clean fun. I thought to myself, as she called me a hopeless sap, my grin got even wider as I made another lap. "Honey, just enjoy yourself. And isn't it a fright? It's the first time that I've carried you since our wedding night." Well, I finally shut the tractor off. I let her sit up there a while. Promised her I'd let her down if she would only smile. By gosh, it was fun. But I have a problem. I can see it now, I can. Gonna take some mighty sweet talking when that light burns out again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gary. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure for me to be here at Elko. This is certainly the largest audience I've ever had the privilege of telling a few stories to, and so I hope you're not nervous. This first story I want to tell you is one I want to dedicate it to all the brother-in-laws in the country. Everybody out there, well, most of you, I bet, has a brother-in-law. The reason I'm going to do this is because of a little incident that happened at our place back Thanksgiving time. We had all the family in, and everybody's getting ready to sit down to dinner. The ladies were putting the finishing touches on, which I found out means making the gravy. And as they was doing that, apparently some of the cracklings fell on the burner, and all of a sudden they had a little flash fire in the kitchen. And of course there were screams and there was yells, and well, we went running in to see what the trouble was, and I saw what had happened, so I hurried out to the garage to get my fire extinguisher and come in and had it out in just a second or two. And everything was going fine except for my brother-in-law. Now, you got to know that he's worked 25 years for the national parks people. Yeah, you're ahead of me, aren't you? Well, I was outside getting that fire extinguisher. He was starting to backfire in the living room. This poem is for all brother-in-laws. I want you to picture this. Ma opened up the mail sack, then gave a shout of glee. It's a letter from my brother. He's going to visit me. Well, folks that are unwelcome quite often come from town. Like the feller from the BLM to cut her units down, or the banker's little helper that wants to take a tally, or the horde of big game hunters that pour into her valley. And though I've made an effort to love all my wife's brothers, I found there's some that I can love a damn sight more than others. And that's when he's a black sheep, least I sees it that way, because he spends his days a lawyering for that dadgum DPA. He bunks in New York City about 30 stories up. He wouldn't know a Hereford cow from a mangy coyote pup. And he's had all the conveniences that come with city life, and well, how we do things on the ranch is worrying the wife. Now, to me, it ain't upsetting that we ain't got a bath. We got a fine two-holer complete with cement path, and says I to Ma, I'll fix it up. He won't have no complaint. We'll mend the roof, put down a rug, put on a coat of paint. I'll fix that outhouse like brand new, a comfortable retreat. We'll use a new Sears catalog. Put fresh varnish on the seat. Well, as I was finishing up my work, the dog set up a den. It was Bubba. In his fancy car, he's just pulling in. He hugged the wife, walked right past me. My pardon, he didn't beg. He headed straight for that outhouse while his poodle rode my leg. I didn't have time to warn him. Likely wouldn't have if I could. In 5 minutes, that wet varnish would bind his hide right good. Lord knows I didn't plan it. Schemes don't turn out so well. By the time I kicked off his poodle, old Bub had started to yell. Ma come running to fetch me. It's Bubby, he's stuck to the seat. Well, I opened the door. There sat Bubby, his pants down around his feet. What he said, we can't put on paper. He was more than a little bit riled. I tried my best to release him while the air became more defiled. At last, says I, it's hopeless. We'll have to undo the seat and take him to town to the doctor. We wrapped him up in a sheet. And we put him in back of the pickup. It hurt him too much to sit down. That sheet was a-flying and flapping 20-odd miles into town. We rounded up Doc in the bar room. It was a day when business was slow. Doc, I says, hurry, we need you. Now, I wasn't expecting a show, but All them cowboys and drifters followed Doc out to the truck where I pulled the sheet off of Bubba. He'd sure had a run of poor luck. Have you ever seen anything like it, Doc? At least anything you can name? Yeah, must have seen maybe 1,000 or so, but never went in a frame.
Because the boss knows what is best. Hi-ho, why should I be grieving? Stormy clouds are leaving. The boss is hanging out a rainbow. Hi-ho, now the grass is greener. Air is cool and cleaner. The boss is hanging out a rainbow. I saw him throw his lariat, a braided lightning strand. I saw him catch those angry clouds and burn them with his brand. Hi-ho, now the sun is blazing. Hungry cattle grazing. The boss is hanging out a rainbow. I saw him throw his lariat, a braided lightning strand. I saw him catch those angry clouds and burn them with his brand. Hi-ho, now the sun is blazing. Hungry cattle grazing. The boss is hanging out a rainbow. The boss is hanging out a rainbow. Shadows have all the room. I was riding free on the old SP, humming a southern tune. When a man came along, made me hush my song, kicked me off away out there. So I threw down my load in that desert road, rested my weary legs too. I watched the sinking sun make the tall shadows run out across that barren plain. Then I hummed a tune to the rising moon. He gets lonesome way out there. Wee-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo-oo
rise to the starless skies. Lost myself in dreams. I dreamed the desert sand was a milk and honey land, and I woke up with start. There's a train coming back on that one-way track, gonna take me way from here. As she was passing by, I caught her on the fly. I climbed in an open door. Then I turned around to that hot desert ground, saw the spot I would see no more. As I was riding away, I heard the pale moon say, farewell, pal, it sure gets lonesome here.
Sons of the San Joaquin. Boys, don't run off. Come over here and join us. There's a feller sitting down here on the other side of Howard. Now, he's a hometown boy. He's homegrown Nevada. He ranches out here in Ruby Valley. He guides up in the Ruby Mountains and packs in there and ranches a place that his granddaddy bought in 1946. And if this boy don't make your jaws hurt when you get through listening to him, I'll eat your hat and mine too. Rod McQuarrie.
Thanks, Red. Thanks, everybody. I call this the Chicken Outfit. I wrote it just a few days ago. Maybe it was a supper. My wife's lasagna is great. Might have been quantity. I know I overate. It was just an average evening. I don't remember what was said. From the warm fire and the darkness, soon I tottered off to bed. And this evil, gruesome nightmare started off polite enough. I was sorting through my mailbag at all this official stuff. Seems I had a letter from an uncle. My grandfolks all had lied, and this brand new, rich, roguish uncle wanted to see me before he died. And when I hurried down to see him, I was shocked to learn he's dead. But then his lawyer told me I'd inherited his spread, about 100 zillion acres, and I thought, this dream is great. I won't have to do the haying. Won't have to do the farming, and there's no need to irrigate. So I asked what breeds were in this stock that I would now be boss, because I figured Coriana, maybe Brahma Cross. And the lawyer said, Rhode Island Red, Banty, and some more. I was puzzled because I hadn't heard of those cow breeds before. And then he told me they were chickens. And I knew the dream was bad, because I'd agreed to run the stock my crazy uncle had. Well, there was 10 straight days of sweaty work before I was content. I made pastures and work bunches for my chicken management. And I had some dandy horses. And I knew I could ride and rope. I figured if I treated them like two-legged cows, then maybe I could cope. Because we know chickens all are stupid. I figured I'd learn what they know quick, and then I'd show my round-ass neighbors some Western chicken tricks. Well, I was riding my first egg pullets when I heard an awful squawk. Then I beheld a nasty sight. My very first egg lock Now, for you chicken raisers, this information I would beg. How do you keep your chick chain from slipping off the egg? I knew she was in trouble, so I really gave her hell. Was the egg delivered backwards? Gee, I really couldn't tell. So now, I had a stifled first egg pullet. And that looks like it should surely hurt, because when you sling a chicken by the hips, their little face goes in the dirt. I figured I'd better cull some roosters. Some were big and sleek and fat, but when I tried to measure scrotums, I didn't have much luck with that. But soon I had some chicken families, and it didn't seem so strange to bunch them easy in a corner and cut out pairs to match my range. Mama hens have lots of babies, and that's a handy thing, it's true. Because when you cut out chicks on horseback, you always stomp a few. Well, I did my best at cutting pears. I used up all my tricks. But when I finished working chickens, I had lots of leppy chicks. This one poor little bugger. Gee, it sure was weird. I told my dog to get him, and poof, he disappeared. I took my few surviving leppies. God, this is hard to tell. I took them to my nurse hen back in the home corral. This one poor little bugger had been in there about a week, and I knew he wasn't sucking. There was no foam on his beak. So I stretched out my old nurse chicken. God, that was the pits. I fumbled there for hours to unplug her chicken tits. Now when you rope and doctor chickens, I will share with you this trick. Pick a strong and healthy chicken. Because by the time they're caught, they're sick. And when you stretch and vaccinate them, if by now you haven't retched, lots of foul claw and bad-eyed chickens died from being overstretched. Many a hapless chicken died, or at my hands ran out of luck, with both my feet on his chicken chest to get my ballin' gun unstuck. Seemed like each night at supper we tried some new fantastic way to cook and eat the chickens who died from doctoring that day. Well, soon I grew despondent. What a bad shape I was in. Each day I'd guzzle about a quart of old Chick Eater's gin. And then I missed a payment. And gosh, it sure was sad, because the Dream Land Bank foreclosed on the place my uncle'd had. And though the sheriff was a Christian soul, he gave me quite a shock when he said that just the land was mortgaged and I had to keep the stock. Well, I loaded up my horses. Coming home, I spared no speed. I was sick of chicken problems and to work for chicken feed. And now I am a wiser man, but humbled, that is true. Though I may be good at other things, I was a damn punk chickaroo.
Rod McQuarrie, wonder. Well, we've had cowboys and neighbors join us from the four corners of the West. There's a young man that rode all the way in from New Mexico to be with us tonight. And all you folks that are lucky enough to own a radio have been entertained by him over the airwaves for a long time. Some of you even seen him on them newfangled things they call televisions he got in the cities. We're proud of him. Would you make welcome Michael Martin Murphy?
Thanks for inviting me, Red. I was explaining earlier that living in New Mexico, we're very aware of the fact that a lot of people would like to come to our country and get jobs here, and they often do illegally without permission. And we see a different side of the story than the politicians. It's really hard to believe, and a lot of people don't believe it when you tell them, the history of this song is that cowboys once deeply desired to get over into Mexican territory to get the good jobs. It was a reverse of what's happening now. There were big ranches there in New Mexico and in Mexican territory. The cowboy would often come over and get himself in trouble, though, and curse the day that he fell in love and couldn't get back across the line. That's what this song is about. Spanish is a loving tongue, soft as springtime, light as spray. There was a girl I learned it from, living down Sonora way. Now I don't look too much like a lover, and yet I say her love words over and over. Late at night, when I'm all alone, mi amor, mi corazón. Now there were nights when I would ride, she would listen for my spurs. She'd fling that big door open wide and raise those laughing eyes of hers. And how those hours would get to flying, but pretty soon I'd hear her crying, please don't leave me all alone, mi amor, mi corazón. Moonlight on the patio, old Senora nodding near me and Juana, talking low, so the old madre could not hear. And once again the hours be flying, pretty soon you'd hear her crying, please don't leave me all alone, mi amor, mi corazón. Then one time I had to fly, I got myself into a foolish gambling fight. I had to say a swift goodbye in that black unlucky night. And traveling north, her words kept ringing in every hoofbeat. I could hear her singing, please don't leave me all alone, mi amor, mi corazón. Well, I ain't never seen her since that night. I can't cross the line, you know. She was Mexican and I was white. Well, like as not, it's better so. And yet I've always sort of missed her since that very first night I kissed her. I left her heart and I lost my own. A
Adios, mi corazón.
Thank you. Thank you. It's nice to know that a song written around 1900 still sounds that good as we approach the turn of the century. A lot of people romanticize the cowboy life, and growing up in Texas and New Mexico, I saw a different side of it. Staring at the south end of northbound cattle, slaving in a saddle all day. There's got to be some kind of natural born fool who wants to live his life this way. So what am I doing here, Lord? What am I doing here? There's got to be something better out there. So what am I doing here? Well, it can't be the cooking. It sure ain't the money. I think the devil made the horse that I ride. Days are long and the nights are too short, and the boss ain't never satisfied. So what am I doing here, boys? Lord, what am I doing here? There's got to be something better out there. So what am I doing here? And sometimes I wonder, in the lightning and the thunder, if a cowboy's even got a prayer. And why'd you have to make it so hard down here when things are so much better up there? Now the Lord called the angels all around the throne. He said, boys, I must be wasting my time. I thought I gave them cowboys a pretty good life, and they're griping till the day they die. What am I doing here, boys? Lord said to his angels, what am I doing here? There's got to be something better out there. So what am I doing here? Boys, what am I doing here? Thank you. Thanks for inviting me. It's a real honor. It's an honor for sure. What's that?
Before we saddle up and move on out of here, I want to do a poem for you that I wrote not long ago that, in my estimation, sums up the way we all feel about our way of life and the way of life we love the best, because the West has a particular code. Not everybody lives by it, but we're glad we got it. Well, his skin looked like leather. He walked with a limp and talked with a slow Texas drawl. His knuckles were knotted and his right thumb was gone. He said a 2-year-old stud bit it off. Now, hell, we knew he was lying. We watched him dally it up. But there ain't no sense in ruining his show. It was Saturday night before the wagon went out, and he'd cornered this new kid we hired on. Now, this ain't the first new hand the old man had cornered, and it's turned into Jake's private game. He turned to me and winked and said, "I'm a schooling the boy about the unwritten laws of the range." Well, the kid was enthralled. He was kind of like in a trance. Jake sensed that he had a good grip, so he straightened up and hitched his pants and took a drink of cold beer and turned around with his hands on his hips, and he said, "Son, a man's brand is his own special mark. It says, this is mine, leave it alone. If you hire out to a man, ride for his brand and protect it like it was your own." Now, Mr. Wagner come out here in 1903. This country was sagebrush, mesquite trees, and sand. And he carved him this ranch out of blood, sweat, and guts. So be proud that you ride for his brand. If you hire out to string barbed wire, build him a fence. It don't matter if it's four or five strands. Remember, it was you who asked for the job. So don't bitch when you ride for this brand. Because Mr. Wagner don't hold with complainers. And he'll fire one before he can quit. So if you don't like this outfit, just head down the trail and find a horse that your saddle will fit. But if you get up early, catch your own bronc, show the boss that you're making a hand, Mr. Wagner will be there to cover your bets as long as you ride for his brand. And then he said, "The winter I spent at the Sixes, we had a man at the old Taylor camp who was out calving heifers and rode smack in the middle of some hiders skinning the cow. Now, he could have rode off and never looked back, but he just wasn't that kind of man. And we found him in Ash Creek, just shot all to hell. No Kona Joe died for the brand." Well, we know the old man tells a windy or two, like the one about losing his thumb. And No Kona was killed in the bars of Fort Worth with the demons and a bottle of rum. But you know, I've been thinking about what he said, and the more of it I understand, the more I believe we'd be all better off if more people would ride for the brand. Thank you. It's very difficult for us to say goodbye. We've had a wonderful time on this stage tonight, and we sure hope we've done some things that you enjoyed listening to. And I would like to personally thank the folks responsible for making the most wonderful event I've ever experienced happen. And I think that all of us owe all of them a great big round of applause, because it takes a lot of hard work to make this come together.